Hi friends, a very good morning. I'm Vishnu Subramaniam from Java's Lab Study A. In this video, we will explore into Fastai Learner class from the learner.py. We'll understand some of the important concepts like what GetAttribute does, and we will understand what is a context manager, and understand what is with events doesn't Fastai fit function, and this particular function is used at multiple places. Once we understand these important concepts, let's quickly go through the fit functionality and see what exactly happens, how it is different from simple Fastai Learner class that is explained in this amazing book, Deep Learning for Coders with Fastai and PyTorch. I made a video on the same, and I'll add link on the top of this video. To understand the Fastai Learner, let's understand first few concepts. What is GetAttr? How self-off event works? In the Fastai Learner class, we'll see a lot of self-off something, like say self-off before fit, self-off after fit. These are events that are triggered at different places of Fastai Learner class. And there's something called callbacks, which are registered to learner, which can have certain functionalities like before fit or after fit, which gets activated when a particular event happens. How that works, we'll look into it. And we will also look at what is a context manager. I found it really amazing how it's being used in the Fastai to have a clean code. We'll also explore an important function called withEvents, which actually helps Fastai Learner to have a very clean code and avoid a lot of boilerplate. And finally, we'll walk through fit the same way we walked through fit from the basic Fastai Learner class. This is going to be a bit longer video, but I'll try my best to keep it as short as possible. Let's understand GetAttr. Fastai gives this class. We can make a class, subclass this, and we can set so any value to the default. In this case, we are saying model. So basically what we are doing is we are setting up a model here, and I'm also using something called store attribute from FastCore. What basically it does is it puts model into self. Basically, it makes it self.model equal to model. So we can say learner.model and we'll have access. And let's create an object of my learner class. And as we can see here, there is nothing called parameters for the learner. So the GetAttr does the magic for us. So GetAttr implements certain functionalities that allows us to pass any of the attributes that are not available directly in our my learner class to model. If it is there in the model, it returns us. So we will be able to use any of the attributes that are available in the model directly from learn. Let's say, for example, PyTorch models has got something called children, which gives access to our entire PyTorch model. So we can also quickly access that. So this is what GetAttr will do, and we will see a lot of Fastai code using this GetAttr. And then let's understand how self of event works. Basically, this code is used for triggering callbacks at multiple places. So let's try to go and look at the init function where we come across this particular event triggering for the first time in the learner class. There's something called self of after create. Let's understand what happens here. When Python sees something like self of this, it basically means that we're trying to call the constructor and we are passing in some argument name, let's say event. So Python, what it does is it calls the call function or method in the Python class and passes any argument that we may pass here. So what is happening inside the Fastai learner classes? We are calling call one, it's a function on top of the event name. And what happens in the call one is we are checking if the event class has any particular event name. Why Fastai is doing this is to ensure that we don't pass an event type which is invalid. Let's say we have something like is my Jupiter alive or some crazy event. Or let's say we did a misspell. Instead of saying after create VSL, we said after create. So just to ensure that we are not triggering wrong events, I would assume that they have this particular line of code which basically checks if the particular event name is valid or not. Event is a class, and it just checks if there is a proper attribute with respect to that event or not. Then let's come to this line, which basically says, let's iterate through a bunch of callbacks. It's not very important at this point of time. And what we're saying is we're again saying CB of event name. So CB here, it can be any of the callback, like train eval callback recorder. And we are passing the event name to this callback. It's like same calling the constructor with particular name. So basically this event is getting triggered to that particular callback. Look at what is event, and then let's come to this. What is the CB of event name? So event is a class that is defined in 13_callback.core in NBS folder under Fastai. It will be under core.py. So what it basically does is it creates a class called event using this function called make class, and it has attributes after backward, after batch, after cancel, and all these things. Basically, these are all different kinds of events for which we write callbacks. So event is basically a class with a bunch of attributes which define our callbacks. Now let's come to the callback here, this line. So what is happening here is we are passing on the event name to CB. This gets actually passed to the callback call function. If you go to our learner, let's open train eval callback. This is one of the callback. Let's search for that. We have it. It's class. And we can see that it's being passed to train eval callback. And train eval callback doesn't have a call. It is implemented in the superclass, just callback. The callback has this call method. Python, when it doesn't find that particular attribute, calls the call method. And the event name is being passed. And there's a bunch of validation that is going on. Once it comes here, this line is important. All it does is, it checks if that particular callback has that particular event name. Let's say, for example, train eval callback, does it have after create or after fit? If it is there, it executes that particular functionality, picks that function and calls that function. If it's not there, then it calls Fastai simple no op function, which basically does nothing. That is what is happening in this particular line. Basically, this is a way to trigger the callback functions in the callback. Now let's try to understand what is a context manager. So it's also seen in the code, where do we come across a context manager for the first time? In the learner class. In the fit, we can see here there is a context manager. So self.addCBS is a context manager. Let's understand what is a context manager and come back. So let's write a simple program here. Before that, let's look at a simple example of a context manager. This is pretty similar to how we open a file, probably write something and close it. When we use with, we don't say file.close. The reason is when we exit out of this with, the file gets automatically closed. The way to implement our own with this kind of functionality is, one of the ways to do is using a context manager. So to any function, we can put a decorator context manager. And anything that we put before try is called start. What happens is whatever we write here gets executed as soon as this line is called. Once we reach yield in the context, the control gets back to the print statement here or any code that we end up writing here. So once we get the control, Python executes all the commands here. Once it gets completed, it again calls the finally. So that is what is happening in the context manager. Let's run it quietly and see what happens. First is setting up our Marvel world. Then we are entering the Marvel universe, hoping to see some of our Marvel characters. And then we are leaving the Marvel world. Now let's take a look at how Fastai Fit uses this. So Fastai has this something called added callbacks, added CBS, which registers any of the callbacks that is being passed to the fit function. So when we say learner.fit, we can pass it in callbacks. And after our training gets executed, it removes all the callbacks. Let's quickly go and see what happens. Okay, I've made it here. So I've copied and pasted it here. So added CBS, what it does is it registers all the callbacks with the learner. That's what add CBS does. It's a very simple function. You can easily go and explore what happens inside. Once it gets yield, it returns the control here and it does all the function will be able to do all the training for us. Once the training is done, it finally calls remove callbacks. So once the fit function finishes its job, the learner, all the callbacks that are associated with the learner that is passed to the fit function will get removed. So we can pass callbacks to the learner at two different places. One is when we initiate a learner and one is when we fit. So the ones which are initiated while creating the learner object will still be available. The ones which are passed when using fit will be removed. So that's what has happening at CBS. Then we will look at one more function called with events, and then I think we will have enough information to go and explore the fit method in the learner class. Let's see what happens in with events. Okay, the actual code looks like this. It's just 3 lines of code. I've slightly rearranged the code so that it's easy to explain. So what is happening is this particular method takes a function, event type, something like fit, validate, train, and then an exception, ex stands here for exception, and some function here, finally some function. And what we do is first we trigger an event. Let's say if event type is fit, we say before fit, and then we execute this function. If there is any exception that raises in these 2 lines, then we trigger another event after cancel fit. After this is completed, we again call after fit. In simple words, let's say if we remove the exception, what happens is we trigger an event before event, after event, between the function. I'm not sure if I said that right. Let me try to rephrase it again. So basically, we call the function. Before calling the function, we trigger a before event type. After the function gets executed, we call after event type. Once all this is done, if there are any cleanups or if you want to do something after, let's say, fit, we put that in final. Most of the times we don't need to do anything. So that's why we have a loop, which does nothing. It's an actual with events. All we did is we just rearranged it for understanding. If you look back at the original code, you can understand that perfectly well. Now, since we have almost everything to understand walkthrough fit, what we will do is we will go through the code in the VS Code, particularly the fit function, and then we'll come back to this to understand what happens in split underscore split. So let's go and look at fit. So what is happening here is to this line, there's a bunch of initializations happening. We are creating an optimizer if it's not already available. We are setting up weight decay to the optimizer, learning rate to the optimizer, and initializing the number of epochs that we need to run the model. The first thing we do is we call doFit, and the event type is fit, exception is cancel, and the cleanup function is the final which we saw is ncleanup. Ncleanup, if you can quickly see, all it does is self.dl x, b, y, b, these are input, y, output, predictions, losses to none. This is actually very important. When we write code in plain vanilla PyTorch, we may end up not releasing up resources and consuming GPU in a particular system. Fastai is doing it in a very systematic way. So let's go into do underscore fit function. So what we are doing here is, we are iterating through epochs. Let's say we want the model to train for 10 epochs. We go through each epoch and we ask to do one epoch at a time. And then here, this is the event type. So we say before epoch, after epoch, run this function called do epoch. If there is an exception, then call it, trigger the cancel epoch exception. In the do epoch, we wanted two steps. Every epoch, we train the model and we validate the model. That's what is here. And both of these more or less call the same functions with one simple difference, which we will look at the end. Let's look at do epoch train. Here we're picking up the train data loader. The DLS is going to contain train and validation or more data loaders. We're picking up the train data loader and we are again calling the self all batches. If you see the with events is repeating everywhere. All batches, here the event type is train and the exception type is cancel train exception. So the function all batches with events function is going to trigger a before train event and call all batches function and then call after train event. Let's call all batches. Now what we're doing is we're iterating through the data loader. Basically, we are getting batches from the data loader and we are passing the index since we're using enumerate. We're passing the index and the batch to one batch. Let's go to one batch and see what happens. We store the index in the iterator and then the set device basically pushes the batch. So what happens is the model, you want always the model to be on the GPU, particularly when you train the model. So we want to push the batch to the device in which the model is set. The set device function does that exactly. And then there is a split function. What it does is, let's look at the JupyterLab. Let's say in a normal scenario, when we do a classification, identify whether a given image is a dog or a cat. That means the input is only one column, which we can say, and the output is one. So in the data loader, we can say till one, choose it as XB, and after one, choose it as YB. So by default, it picks up one. Or if it's more than one, it treats all other columns as targets. Sometimes what we may want is, we have two, three inputs. Let's say we have an image and we have a text and then we want to predict something out of that. Then we want two inputs. It's the simplest way to do is pass on the n underscore input to DLS. We can say DLS.n underscore input to two or three. Then what happens in the split function is, the XP takes the first three set of values from the data loader as input and the remaining as output. That's what is happening in the underscore split. This is mostly not required if you're doing a simple classification problem, but if you're doing tabular, when you're doing multi-model kind of models, it's very useful. Then let's go to do one batch. And this is where the actual passing the inputs to the model, calculating the preds, triggering an event after pred, then checking if, I think here we are checking if the output is null. If the output is not null, then we are calculating the loss. We are storing the loss, making a clone and storing it. We are triggering another event after loss. And we are also checking training is true or not. And if either training is false or YB is null, we return. If it's not, then we do backward propagation and we do optimizer and we zero the gradients. This is what is happening in do one batch. The same steps more or less happens with do validate also. Let's go to do epoch validate also does the same thing except for one key difference. Here we pick up the data loader based on the index. When train, we just say DLS.train. I think this is returned here in this particular way because we can have multiple data loaders. Like say we have a validation data loader. Sometimes we may have a test data loader. So we want to choose based on the index. We can pass the index to pass the index here and it takes it. And the other important thing is here we're passing validate. So what happens is it triggers an event called before validate and after validate. So what it means is the callbacks that we have can actually manipulate the training variable or any variable that is associated with the learner. So if we have seen in the entire learner code, we have not seen the training attribute being set to true or model.train, model.eval, which we generally do in PyTorch. It's not being shown here. The reason is that is being pushed to train eval callback. Let's search for train eval callback. If you see here, there's a callback function called before train and before validate. And inside this, we have self.model.train, self.learner.train. That's how we are manipulating the different attributes of the learner. So we have explored almost all the functionalities of the fit or the learner. Of course, there are much more, which we would probably look in another video. I still have to explore those things. Once I understand and if there is enough complexity in those things, I'll be happy to make a video. Or if you like it, just let me know in the comments. I'll make a video. So I think we have enough information now to understand what happens inside a Fastai learner and how it is different from simple PyTorch training loop. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you have any suggestions or comments, please leave it in the comment section. Be happy to take it. Thank you. Bye-bye.